Hello students, so in this lecture we shall talk about lasing. And semiconductors. Now, semiconductor is not a two or three level atomic systems which we require for lasing. But it consists of electron and hole distributed in energy in their respective bands. Now, therefore, the concept of population inversion is a little different in semiconductors. So, as you know, that for lasing, we require a population. The very first requirement for a laser is the population inversion. Means, unlike the normal case, there should be more number of atoms at higher energy level than in the lower energy level. Now, in the case of a semiconductor, since there are no two or three, only electrons and holes, so the population inversion in the mechanism in a semiconductor will be little different. So, now, for a pure semiconductor, at 0 Kelvin, the valence band is completely filled. Whereas the conduction band is completely empty. Now, this is how you can draw. This is your conduction band and this is your valence band. And this is your EG or energy band gap. Now, when E is equal to H mu, this amount of energy is supplied, electron is excited occupying the lowest state in the conduction fan. So, when this is, so from this causes an electron from the valence band to go to the conduction band and attain a region EFN, that is the lowest state in the conduction band. And this EFN is actually equal to EF0, the energy associated with, or EFP, energy associated with holes. So if this is the conduction band and this is the valence band. So an electron moving from this place to this place will be in this range of energies, and this is your EFN, and same amount of energy will be will also be present. So this is again, this region is EFP, and this is EFN, and these two are equal. So then there is an H mu coming and hitting the target. Now, once the situation is created, photons with energy greater than Eg but less than delta EF cannot be observed. So, in this case, if photons of energy which are less than the band gap, this is Eg, and which are even less than the difference between the two energy levels, that means EFn minus EFp. It cannot be observed. However, photons with energy in this range can induce stimulated downward transitions from free conduction band state to empty conduction band state. So both of them can be observed, but they can induce stimulated downward transition. Filled conduction band state to empty valence band state. Filled conduction band to empty valence band state. Now, the absorption rate of the photons of energy E can be represented as absorption rate and the stimulated rate here. Let me tell you what is actually P here is the transition probability. And NE μe, and it is the density of photons of energy E. E2 and E1 are the two states. Similarly, as we have found out the rate of absorption, there will be a rate of stimulated emission rate. It's called RST. And is equal to PFn E2 multiplied by 1 minus FP E1 into NPE. This FE and FN as indicated here, and also used here, Fe and Fn. These are the Fermi functions. So Fn function of E is equal to 1 minus minus EFN by KT. Plus 1 and FPE is equal to again 1 minus E minus EFP by KT plus 1. These are the Fermi functions and EFN and EFP, these are the quasi Fermi levels for electron and holes. I am Arias. Now when an excitation source is creating excess carriers, so when excitation is creating excess carriers, we can say that EFN, the EFN is equal to EFP is equal to EF. Now this is when the excess carriers are removed. And they are removed, so both of them are equal. And the difference between these two, the difference between EFN and EFP, the measure of deviation from equation. FNE as equal to exponential EFN minus EF by KT and FPE as equal to exponential E minus EF. The non-equilibrium carrier concentration non-equilibrium carrier concentration is given as N is equal to NC exponential EFN minus EC by KT and P again NC or NV. The number of carriers in the conduction band is the number of carriers in the valence band, exponential EV minus EFP by KT. Now, for a net stimulated emission or optical gain, this gain, we can have a rate of stimulated emission greater than the rate of absorption. Or we should have the Fermi occupation index of level 2, or it should be equal greater than the occupation index of occupation index of electrons in level 2 should be more than the occupation electrons of holes in the level 1. So this is the condition of occupation inversion. Have a difference in energy EFN minus EFP, and it should be greater than the energy of the excitation. Now, the process of stimulated downward transition presents gain in the leasing medium. So, stimulated downward transition. This indicates that there is a gain in leasing medium. And similarly, stimulated upward transition or absorption means a loss. And so, absorption. Will represent a loss, well, stimulated downward transition will eliminate a gain. So you can actually find out the gain and the loss in the following manner. So if gain curve can be presented as following manner. So if you write gain here, you can write loss here. So we can represent it by the following function. So if n is equal to 0, then it will show up like this. When n is equal to 1, it will show up like this. With respect to E, and this is the band gap. Now the gain becomes positive for H nu is equal to band gap. Goes to maximum and becomes zero. So it becomes positive, like here, goes to max, like in this case, and then it comes to zero. This is the trend. And it will occur if H nu is equal to, or almost equal to, the delta EF. I guess the difference between EFN and P. Now, that energy is much larger than E. So, if E is much greater than the band gap energy, which is actually H nu, the occupation of electron and holes in the respective band is negligible, and the gain curves are so then. The occupation of electrons and holes becomes negligible, and the gain curves, which is for the gain curve, Cn, the gain curves in this case are given as Ge. Is equal to minus alpha E, where it is an absorption coefficient. Now, looking to the density of electromagnetic waves in a cavity, is given as G nu d nu is equal to 8 pi nu squared d nu by c cube. So if you draw the waves, it will look like this. It is the length L, the cavity. So for lambda is equal to 2L, the shape for lambda is equal to L will be of this shape, and for lambda is equal to L by 3 will be of this shape. Now, electromagnetic radiation in a cavity involves perfect reflectors. It will be standing waves. So, EM waves in a cavity where the walls are perfect reflectors. So, be standing waves. Now, the density of function is a mode of energy position, and an ideal gas molecules has a degree of freedom. Degree of freedom for an ideal gas molecule is 3. So the average total energy is 3 by 2 kg, corresponding to kinetic energy motion. Now, for one dimensional harmonic oscillator, has 2 degrees of freedom. For the both kinetic and potential energy. Now, because the standing waves in the cavity originates in an oscillating electric charge, the standing waves, they are originating from oscillating electric charge. So the two degree of freedom are associated with the wave, and it should have the same energy. That means this should be the average energy of the degrees of freedom. Now, total energy U nu d nu per unit volume in the cavity for frequency range between mu and mu plus d nu, total energy range, is equal to average into the g nu d nu, which makes it 8 pi kt by c cube into mu square d nu. And this is the Rayleigh-Jeans formula, the Rayleigh-Jeans formula. The Planck's radiation formula, on the other hand, says that U nu U nu, this should be equal to 8 pi square by C cube into H2 e to the power H mu by KT minus 1 d. And for lasers, we need to have Einstein's AB coefficients. So we can have and the difference between the two B and B coefficients is actually equal to 8 this rather. That is 8 by 8 by H